Welcome back to Movie Recap. Today I'm gonna show you a 2014 American war drama film called Field of Lost Shoes. Spoilers ahead. Watch out and take care. The movie begins during the deadly American Civil War, wherein the superintendent celebrates the parade at VMI to honor cadets who gave their lives at a turning point during the American War. Then, upon narrating the story, there are seven friends attempts marching into the Battle of New Market, yet only four came out in the year 1864 on May 15th. Afterward, a narrator named John tells his story when he's at the age of 12, wherein his father becomes the governor of Virginia. Unfortunately, none of them know that their world is about to explode over the issues of slavery in America. Because of that, his father's heart has long since changed on the topic. Then, one night, his father takes him to a place that would change him forever. During the night, his father approaches him suddenly asks if he's rereading The Englishman. John loves to read a book with long titles. So, he answers and laughs, telling his father that he will get shot for treason once they find out he's reading a book that's forbidden for them to read. His father then laughs, walking towards him as John's father says it will likely happen. Then, upon sitting, John recites the book's genres, the personal history, adventures, experiences, the observation of Copperfield, and the younger Blunderstone rookery. Suddenly, his father interrupts him, saying that the author of the book he is reading fails to publish in any of his accounts. Because of that, John stops reading, and comes with his father. Afterward, John and his father go out as his father tells him that they're going for a bit of a ride. Suddenly, John talks, saying he dislikes his father's surprise trips anymore. Yet, his father answers, saying that his trips are usually a lesson in his life. Eventually, John agrees as the carriage begins to move. While they are on a trip, John's father orders him to tell the story about the play his mother took him to in Philadelphia, the Uncle Tom's Cabin. Afterward, John suddenly feels discomfort as he says that they will only disagree upon their discussion. Later, they arrive at Philadelphia, where the slave auction is happening. Afterward, John starts walking towards the events area when suddenly his father attempts to leave him, saying that he has never known his son, John, to need help making up his mind. Leaving him no choice, John continues to attend the slave auction without his father. Then upon entering, John sees an American selling the black Americans, including children, to serve them. Unfortunately, John witnesses a mother crying after taking her children away from her because one of the Americans buys them. Because of that, John emotionally walks out. 5 years later, Civil War suddenly closed in on Shenandoah Valley, a home place to the military schools that his father sent him after becoming a general in the Confederate Army. Eventually, John turns 17 years old, and he's already in his second year at the Virginia Military Institute. Then, as John runs upon entering his school, two soldiers suddenly mock him. Afterward, they try to approach a young lad named Bobby, looking for someone to help him carry his container. Fortunately, Sam Atwell from the upper-level student volunteers to help Robert. Suddenly, Sam sees something forbidden to bring upon the military school, a concealed foodstuff. Because of that, Sam calls Cadet Garland the officer of the day, as Bobby accidentally makes a clear violation of institute regulations. Afterward, Bobby begins defending himself, saying that he doesn't know how it got to his barracks, but Sam is still eager to punish him. Then, upon entering, Garland says that if he takes charge of Bobby's case, it will go to the faculty, which will make him horrible. So, Sam orders Duck to fetch John instead of handling Bobby to the barracks. A while later, Bobby meets John, who immediately asks if he does it, but then, Bobby tells the truth, swearing to his father's soul that he didn't intentionally bring the food. Luckily, John believes him, and tells the cadets to settle it inside instead because it could be bad for Cadet Jefferson if his case gets out. Therefore, there must be some punishment, in which Bobby will submit to a caning. Afterward, Duck orders Bobby to take his shirt off as John proclaims that Bobby is his rat, which John officially makes him part of their group cadet. The following day, a very different kind of general named Ulysses Grant arrives at the White House as President Abraham Lincoln calls a meeting with him. Afterward, Abraham their discussion after congratulating Ulysses for his promotion and victory, saying that he is a general that the nation has been praying for. Abraham also points out that Ulysses is a kind of soldier that fights like a savage. Suddenly, Ulysses agrees with both as he says that war is not an opera nor theater, but it is for winning. A winning in which it ends with death and destruction while beginning to heal. Afterward, Abraham answers by a question, asking if achieving to win requires brutality. So, Ulysses points out if they're going to play chess or war because he will attack their enemies at all times and places once Abraham appoints him as general-in-chief. Ulysses also says he will take the enemy's flower of his youth, and destroy everything he loves, and anything that might give him the means of hope to prevail. Meanwhile, the former Vice President of the United States named, Confederate Major John C. Breckinridge, drives his way to the Shenandoah Valley, overlooking the New Market Gap with Confederate Major Charles Semple. Upon riding a horse, the former Vice President presumes that Ulysses Grant will send his soldiers to the New Market, yet Charles disagrees with him. So, Confederate Major John is eager to predict that the Federals will come soon, and orders Charles to inform his brigade commanders to concentrate the army, and move the best speed towards the New Market. Charles then, confirms if Confederate Major John is sure about telling General Lee that he's wrong with his prediction. Only then receives an answer from him that Confederate Major John doesn't have to repeat himself if Charles listens. At Virginia Military Institute, Bobby suddenly passes out while practicing with other cadets at the field. So, Duck, and Sam, help him get into the girls' boarding house adjacent to VMI to rest. Then, on the other hand, John eventually reports that the battalion is ready as all cadets are present and accounted. However, upon taking Bobby to the boarding house, Sam suddenly meets a beautiful young girl, and eventually stutters from speaking as he talks with her. So, the young girl calls her mother instead to entertain Sam. Unfortunately, the young girl's mother finds out that Bobby gets drunk after drinking alcohol, and it is because of Sam and the other cadets. Meanwhile, Ulysses calls for a meeting at his Union Field headquarters to plan their mission. While Ulysses listens, he hears Captain Henry talking about taking the main army in the south towards Richmond while sending General Ziegel west to the Shenandoah Valley, which is General Lee's breadbasket of the south. Afterward, he points out that if they take the valley before the summer harvest, they will cut off Lee's food supply and end the war. Suddenly, Ulysses excuses Henry to say that their campaign will be something of a family affair because their first lady, Mary Todd, is a cousin to the rebel general that will face in the valley, Confederate Major John. So, Ulysses clears Captain Henry's mistake about General Ziegel being a politician, not a soldier. Meaning General Ziegel's only job is to take the railroad. Meanwhile, Confederate Major John immediately receives news from his daughter about Ulysses experiencing a big problem. The only sizable force that he can throw at them is General Ziegel. Confederate Major John also says to Charles that Ulysses knows that General Ziegel is a nuisance, and so he presumes that Ulysses will send a real soldier to beat them. Afterward, Confederate Major John reveals that they will help General Lee to rescue his army against Ulysses. Later, Captain Henry arrives at Union General Franz Ziegel's temporary headquarters. Afterward, he bows down him, then says that he has the honor of providing artillery support for his advance. Unfortunately, General Ziegel ignores him, and proceeds to walk towards the meeting room first before talking. Afterward, General Ziegel says that Ulysses sends Captain Henry only to spy on them. So, Captain Henry immediately defends himself, saying that he only wishes to provide the best possible support for his command. Captain Henry then asks if there is any map on his route, and any intelligence of the enemy's dispositions or intentions. To General Ziegel's dismay, he approaches Captain Henry and says that Ulysses is his patron, so let him provide whatever Captain Henry needs. Unfortunately, Captain Henry fails to convince General Ziegel to join their troops. Meanwhile, Charlie immediately delivers the message to Confederate Major John about the unsure arrival of their troops. So, he suggests another plan to solve their problem, sending 274 strong corps of cadets to protect the valley, only if Wharton and Eccles' troops are getting delayed. Unfortunately, Confederate Major John disagrees with Charlie's plan, saying that if they put the cadets into a battle, what kind of dire circumstances will they find themselves in? But then, Charlie is eager to convince Confederate Major John to get the boys into the reserves. Luckily, Confederate Major John finally agrees with him. Meanwhile, Charlie immediately drives his way to the Virginia Military Institute to talk with the superintendent. Then, upon entering his office, Charlie reports about General Ziegel's forces to proceed south through the valley at best speed. Luckily, the superintendent volunteers to send his corps of cadets for Confederate Major John. Later at night, Captain Chinook calls the battalion to position themselves as he announces that the enemy is in heavy force is advancing up the Shenandoah Valley, and General Lee cannot spare troops from the Army of Northern Virginia to meet the advance. So, all the available forces of Southern Virginia and elsewhere are now to assemble in Staunton to defend the valley. Unfortunately, the cadets receive an order to march northward toward the strategic valley's choke point of New Market as the superintendent forms them with four companies of infantry, and one section of artillery by the valley pike. The following day, the corps of cadets immediately prepares themselves to fall in. Afterward, Captain Chinook shouts as he orders them to begin marching. Then, upon marching, some of the boys play with the instruments while women on the street cheer them for a bit of good luck. However, John suddenly sees the woman he had seen at the slavery auction he attended when he was 12 years old. Later at night, the corps of cadets attends a party before going into the battle. Then, On the other hand, Sam enjoys watching his friends entertain some young women when suddenly he sees the love of his life at the party. So, Sam immediately approaches her, and eventually realizes that she will also go to the new market to aid the wounded soldiers. Afterward, Sam receives scrunchies from her as a sign of good luck and a symbol to remember her. Afterward, Sam talks with John, saying he worries about him because he won't make it out of the valley if John doesn't believe in what he's fighting for. So, John answers, saying that a man believes that his cause is only to die for it gladly. But then, Sam seems unhappy to hear John's answer and shares his opinion, telling John that defending their homeland against the strangers is purely a sign of them not enslaving people. But the South's way of life has been dependent on enslaved people for over 200 years, and if John tore it all to pieces at once, he would destroy the rest of them. However, John is eager to trust his belief not to defend Virginia, but only his family and the school he belongs. Later, Confederate Major John meets the Corps of Cadets while recognizing Governor Wise's son, John. Afterward, he talks with the boys, saying that their purpose of coming to the headquarters is because of his fault, and leaves no choice, but to make a difficult decision by involving them. Confederate Major John then asks about their thoughts about the war. Fortunately, the boys agree to join the battle with Confederate Major John to protect their valley against Ulysses and General Zeagle. On the day of the battle at the New Market, Captain Chinook calls the Corps of Cadets to pray as they prepare for the war. Afterward, the boys march towards the field's location to meet the enemies. Then, on the other hand, Captain Henry orders his soldier to bring the 34th Massachusetts forward, back from their defensive positions to the east. Luckily, Eccles' troops eventually join Confederate Major John by positioning themselves on the battlefield. Confederate John Major then orders Charles to get the Corps of Cadets at the very rear to protect them. Later, the battle begins as Captain Henry signals his men to commence fire. So, Captain Chinook arrives to assist the Corps of Cadets while Charlie orders him to drive his men straight down into the valley once they go over the crest of the hill. Afterward, the Corps of Cadets start marching together with the other troops joining Confederate Major John's forces. However, while the troops of Captain Henry keep on commencing fire, the Corps of Cadets continue to march despite the possibility of getting killed. Because of that, some of Captain Henry's soldiers convince him to stop the bombing as they are already vulnerable. Yet, Captain Henry is eager to defend the hill, and orders his men to continue commencing fire. Then, on the other hand, the Corps of Cadets proceeds to take an advance on taking the hill against the enemy while the 34th Massachusetts begin to fire them. Meanwhile, Charles talks with Confederate Major John, saying that the enemy had torn the center of their line, so they must put in the reserves to restore the line. Charles also states that once the Union forces regroup and counterattack, the line will divide into two, and they'll put right through the hole in the center. So, Confederate Major John accepts Charles' suggestion, and orders to put the Corps of Cadets into the line. Afterward, the Corps of Cadets fill in the gaps, and begin shooting the enemies using their guns. Suddenly, the boys start to fix their bayonets as they decide to attack to get the weapons from the enemies before they get blown apart. Eventually, the boys take their decision without permission from Confederate John Major. The movie ends with the Corps of Cadets sacrificing themselves to fight against the enemies without the assistance of other troops that joined forces with Confederate Major John. Then, upon their attack, the General of 34th Massachusetts orders one of his soldiers to shoot Sam first before retreating. Surprisingly, the Corps of Cadets win against the enemies, and conquers Bushong Hill while raising their flags. However, the battle causes severe injuries, missing shoes in the field, and deaths of other cadets, including Sam, Jacqueline, and Jefferson, that get killed by the guns and explosions. Thank you for watching. Subscribe for more videos like this to help the channel out. Have a nice day.